World War II, a desperate time when humans found new and more terrible ways of killing each other. Out of this desperation came the Japanese suicide bomber known as the kamikaze. To the kamikaze, bomb and bomber were one and the same. They were willing to guide their planes into targets in the name of the emperor. They were told they'd become gods. Now, for the first time in all color, a look at the men who were willing to embrace death and the devastation and agony they caused. These are the kamikazes. In the final 10 months of World War II, the Empire of the Rising Sun was in dire circumstances. As a last-ditch weapon, Japanese admirals and generals directed over 2,500 men to forfeit their lives as part of organized suicide missions. The world remembers them today collectively as kamikazes. The toll of the kamikazes was terrible. Scores of Allied ships were sunk or damaged beyond repair. Many more were damaged badly enough to take them out of the war. More than 7,000 Allied servicemen and women lost their lives due to the aerial suicide bombings from the advent of the kamikaze corps. Tens of thousands more were wounded, incredible suffering caused by just 2,500 kamikaze pilots, incalculable damage to families on all sides of the war. Girls and boys who lost their fathers. Mothers whose sons would never come home. These kamikazes leave behind a bitter and tortured legacy. They sacrifice themselves for an ideal, but in vain. Their name means divine wind. They were to blow back the invaders. The wind was strong, but did not prevail. How far the empire had fallen, but the beginning of the downfall was a full 2 years before the introduction of the kamikazes. After the Japanese attack on Pearl Harbor stunned the world, American forces had rallied to prepare a global assault on the aggressor. Japanese pilots had sunk the heart of the U.S. Pacific Fleet, but missed precious aircraft carriers that were out to sea during the attack. Those flat tops would form the core of a counterattack meant to level the playing field in the Pacific. April 18, 1942, just 5 months after Pearl Harbor, Lieutenant Colonel Jimmy Doolittle and his men take off from the aircraft carrier, the USS Hornet. Hitting targets in Tokyo, the 16 B-25s bring the war to the Japanese people. It is clear to both sides, airplanes and the flat tops that deliver them are going to be vital during this war. 3 months later, in June, the Japanese attacked Midway Island, but the Americans had broken the Japanese code and were ready and waiting. The Japanese lost 322 planes, 4 carriers, and 3,500 men of the Rising Sun, including their best aviators at Midway. Admiral Isoroku Yamamoto was at the helm of the failed strike on Midway Island, with Vice Admiral Chuichi Nagumo in charge of the carrier force. There is evidence that even then, aides suggested using ramming attacks in which the pilot would be sacrificed. Yamamoto refused to listen. The humiliation of the first naval defeat for Japan since the 1500s caused the average Japanese citizen to wonder, perhaps for the first time, why they were fighting.
We started hearing about the defeat at Midway from the carrier pilots. The more I heard their stories, the angrier I was. Not towards the enemy, but towards Vice Admiral Nagumo and his staff who took command. Yasunaga Hiroshi, pilot.
In addition to the aircraft carriers which were saved from Pearl Harbor, the Americans developed faster and more maneuverable Essex-class carriers, which they were churning out at an astonishing pace. These floating cities of 3,500 men were getting closer and closer to being able to reproduce Doolittle's 1942 raid on the home island. Throughout 1942 and 1943, U.S. forces moved ever closer to Tokyo. The importance of air superiority was so keenly felt that the Japanese Navy's Air Fleet Commander-in-Chief, Takajiro Onishi, committed the heresy of suggesting that they scrap the pride of the fleet, the Yamato, and use the metal to build airplanes. Lack of airplanes wasn't the only problem. The Japanese needed people who could fly. On June 19, 1944, in what has come to be known as the Great Marianas Turkey Shoot, the Empire of the Rising Sun lost 10 times as many planes as the Allies. When the smoke cleared, Japan had few planes or pilots left. And while more planes could be built, trained and talented aviators were not so easy to replace. As the Allies continued their island-hopping campaign, the Imperial Armed Forces found themselves in increasingly dire straits. The Mitsubishi Zero, which had ruled the skies at the beginning of the war, could not go as high or as fast as the new American fighters. Very soon, the U.S. forces would be close enough to threaten the home islands. The Allies continued their successful strategy of island hopping. But as they drew closer to Japan, they were beginning to understand the fierceness with which the Japanese citizens were prepared to protect their homeland. At Saipan, countless people, civilians and soldiers alike, took their own lives rather than end up in enemy hands. Believing that they would be enslaved, raped, and killed by the invaders, many chose to take poison or hold a grenade against themselves and pull the pin rather than surrender. One soldier wrote in his diary,
"I have come at last to the place where I will die. I am pleased to think that I will die calmly, in the true samurai style."
Shocked American troops began to realize that the Eastern attitudes toward suicide differed radically from theirs. They witnessed the unthinkable. Meanwhile, in Europe, the Allies had already made their D-Day landing in Normandy and were moving on to liberate Paris. After that, it would be on to Berlin. Hitler was in serious trouble, and Japan was facing up to the possibility that it might lose the first war in its history, and it had no friends left to help it. It was a bitter pill that the Emperor's military leaders were not ready to swallow. With the Axis crumbling, it would soon be Japan versus the rest of the world. This was the situation as the American task forces assembled in October 1944 in Leyte Gulf off the Philippines. If the Allies took back the Philippines, it would only be a matter of time until they took Formosa, Okinawa, Kyushu, and the main island itself. The Japanese countered with a plan, the Sho, or Victory Operation, to repel the invaders. Several military leaders argued that, just for this campaign, the use of ramming attack should be employed. The most vocal was Air Fleet Commander-in-Chief Takajiro Onishi. In the 21st century, we have become used to technology like heat-seeking missiles and smart bombs. But in those days, bombs and torpedoes were dropped with only the hope that they would hit the intended target. The Allies would drop 3 and 4 times the amount of bombs necessary to disable a target, knowing that much of the bomb load would not hit the intended objective. The Japanese military simply didn't have those kinds of resources. But what if every hit counted, reasoned Onishi? What if the bomb could be guided so that each and every one reached its target every time? One airplane, one ship went the theory, but the theory needed to be proven. Rear Admiral Masafumi Arima decided that he was just the man for the job. He boarded his plane and didn't stop until he found an aircraft carrier. The crew of the USS Franklin watched in astonishment as he got closer and closer. Maybe the pilot was dead and had lost control. Still, it looked like he was aiming for the deck. Arima slammed into the Franklin. The date was October 13, 1944. Thousands more would follow him over the next 10 months. The kamikaze, the divine wind, was born. No one could have predicted that the wind would soon become a full-fledged storm. The first Divine Wind squads were formed in October of 1944 and based out of Clark Airfield in the Japanese-occupied Philippines. They were officially dubbed the Special Attack Force. Upon the decision to form the unit, Air Fleet Commander-in-Chief Takajiro Onishi called for volunteers from the flyers in the 201st Air Group who were not family men.
Japan is in grave danger. Thus, on behalf of your 100 million countrymen, I ask you this sacrifice and pray for your success. I shall watch your efforts to the end and report your deeds to the throne.
The entire unit volunteered. They would fly their missions until none of them were left. Onishi swore to follow them. These volunteers were a tremendous roadblock to the Allies' plans to take the Philippines back. As the Battle of Leyte Gulf began on October 22nd, fear and panic reigned on the American side because, indeed, there was little defense against the new kamikaze squads. At first, they were believed to be ordinary pilots with engine trouble trying to do some extra damage. But as the numbers increased, the reality sunk in.
An innovation of this battle is the suicide dive. A countermeasure must be found soon. Captain Ray Tarbuck, senior naval representative to General MacArthur.
Unlike a high-altitude bombing run, the kamikaze strike was almost a personal assault, an aviator's version of hand-to-hand combat.
I can still see his helmet, goggles, and face as the plane and pilot sank into the sea. Tommy Alexander, USS Princeton.
Even when they missed, Japanese special attack fighters got closer to their prey than ever before. Here, The crew of the USS Essex watches in horror as the pilot follows his plane into the water.
We didn't see him until he was about 8,000 yards away. This one came in low and fast, and how he ever got through all the stuff we threw at him, I'll never know. But he did. Lieutenant Harry Stanley, Gunnery Officer, USS Bush.
Sailors could often inspect what was left of the plane, and many times the pilot's body, after the crash. Ironically, these pilots, who had done their best to kill everyone on the ship, were sometimes buried with full military honors. Within Japan, the method of attack was hailed as the ultimate secret weapon, a new and glorious invention in the art of war. The Knights of the Divine Wind were cheered as saviors and as gods.
The Kamikaze Corps guards the imperial nation and has admirably demonstrated the pure hearts of the Japanese. Radio Tokyo, October 28, 1944.
One mother wrote to her child in the Corps, "You are my son, and you are not my son. You are the son of the Emperor." U.S. admirals agonized over what to do about the suicide bombers. The Commander-in-Chief of Pacific Operations, Admiral Chester W. Nimitz, was so taken aback, he ordered a news blackout of the development. A total embargo against any mention of suicide bombers was strictly enforced. After all, how could they tell the mothers and wives back home that the enemy had a new weapon, one that could only be stopped when Japan ran out of pilots? Japanese Air Fleet Commander Onishi realized that there was great support among the U.S. public for the war, but he also gambled that the kamikazes would terrify the Americans into negotiating a truce. The U.S. news embargo was proof that Onishi was onto something. This article goes out of its way to suppress the emerging rumors, saying the suicide pilot was already dead. The real truth was too horrible to reveal. Navy gunners knew how to aim at the broad underbelly of enemy planes, which they had dubbed with colorful names like Oscar and Val. But a plane diving down right above you is much harder to hit with anti-aircraft artillery. This fact allowed the Japanese Special Attack Forces to inflict severe damage on Allied ships as the Battle of Leyte Gulf raged on during October 1944. The method was so revolutionary that U.S. anti-aircraft guns had to be reconfigured to prevent them from hitting their own superstructure. From the beginning, there were two main plans of attack employed by the Divine Wind. The first, favored by Air Fleet Commander-in-Chief Onishi, involved flying toward the target at a very low altitude, right above the waves, in order to evade radar. With the target ship in sight, the aviator would gain altitude in order to build up speed for the final plunge. The second method, favored by the Japanese Army Air Force, which soon formed its own special attack force, worked best when there was heavy cloud cover. It called for the pilot to climb to extreme heights and then come down at an angle as the target ship came in range. Either way, these were far from the spur-of-the-moment attacks the Allies first thought they were witnessing. About the best that the gunners could hope to do was throw all the AK-AK artillery they could at a plane until it either disintegrated or fell into the sea and out of harm's way. The pilots were instructed to aim for the flat top's elevators. In many ways, the elevator was the heart of the carrier. Thus, a blow to the lifts would cause the maximum damage, since it would take out as many airplanes as possible in the hangar and at the same time make normal flight operations, including storing and moving the aircraft, impossible. Others were told to take out the decks that served as the floating tarmac for these mobile air bases. Because the Americans used wooden decks, even a glancing blow could shut the ship down for weeks. Even if the ship itself went undamaged, the planes on deck were also a valuable target. Because the carriers stored ammunition and fuel for their aircraft, and because the Japanese special attack planes were equipped with 550-pound bombs themselves, the high-velocity dives caused violent explosions. The kind of decimation that Air Fleet Commander-in-Chief Onishi had hoped for. In fact, the Zero fighter's downfall, the reason it had been derided as a gas tank with wings, made it a very effective suicide bomb. Its lack of armor almost guaranteed explosion on impact, and the more fuel aboard, the better. Overpowering fires often ensued. Only the skill and bravery of the damage control parties kept the casualty numbers from being catastrophic. After the fire came the back-breaking duty of cleaning up. Often the water and foam used to put out the fires did their own harm to the ship's equipment. To the pilots of the Divine Wind, the only thing more harrowing than the prospect of dying was the prospect of not dying. Not being able to find the enemy ships. In such cases, the flyers were told to return to base and prepare for sure death on another day. No one can know the psychological torture that produced.
We lined up, our heads hanging, in front of the commandant. He said simply, "It can be helped, a pity, but you will have another opportunity to destroy the aircraft carriers." We looked at one another in silence. Nagatsuka Ryuji, Japanese Army Air Force.
After a task force was sighted, the kamikazes would typically fly in a formation of 5 to 10 aircraft, with just a few of the planes earmarked for sure-death missions. The others were there to provide cover so that the newly appointed gods would increase their chances of reaching the target. They were also there to document and report the results for transmission to the emperor. Historians have later suggested that the escort also served to ensure that none of the pilots would try to break their date with destiny. To further baffle the enemy, the kamikaze squads would make it a policy to ride in behind a returning group of friendlies. American radar was sophisticated, but it wasn't sophisticated enough to sort out who was who. Although dusk was a particularly auspicious time for a kamikaze mission, suicide runs could happen at any time of day or night. The number one instruction, more important than where and how to attack, was stated best by one Japanese special attack commander. He told his flyers, "Come back dead." In just the first few days of the Battle of Leyte, nearly every U.S. aircraft carrier in the task group off of the Philippine Islands had been hit by the new suicide divers. On the third day of the battle, October 25, 1944, another wave of kamikazes was launched against Task Force 77 near the island of Samar. The final pilot of the squad, thought to be Lieutenant Yukio Seki, put the escort carrier, the Saint Lo, in his sights and crash dove on the deck. These paintings by the brother of one of the Saint Lo's gunners tell the story. At first, the damage to the escort or jeep carrier, as the converted merchant vessels were known, didn't seem too serious, until the bomb, carried by the kamikaze, detonated in the hangar deck, causing the aircraft fuel to ignite. To make matters worse, the sprinkler system failed. The fire raged out of control as torpedoes, depth charges, and other bombs exploded from the heat. 8 heavy explosions followed, flinging men into the ocean. It also opened gaping holes where the flat top took on water. Captain F.J. McKenna prepared to abandon ship. A second wave of bogies, primarily Yokosuka dive bombers, arrived just 20 minutes later, and the Combat Air Patrol had all it could do to keep those at bay. Finally, an escort cruiser put out the St. Lowe's fires, but it was too late. 10 minutes after the fires went out, the St. Lowe went to the bottom. The first sinking due to a suicide mission. The St. Lowe lost 114 men that day. Another 784 were rescued from the treacherous waters. Many men in the water cried as they saw their homes slide under the waves. The dream of the kamikaze's originators, one plane, one ship, had come true. The Corps was so successful, and the Japanese situation still so tenuous, that it was too compelling to stop with the defense of the Philippines as planned. Ramming attacks were so powerful, they could almost be described as addictive. The divine wind was here to stay. How were so many compelled to give up everything for the sake of a falling empire? These pilots were the newest embodiment of a divine wind that had protected the island of Japan for centuries. The year 1281. Kublai Khan has decided that the Mongolian Empire should expand to the islands of Japan. The head of the Japanese military, the Shogun, has other ideas. The Mongols amass a huge army on the Chinese and Korean coasts, ready to invade. Badly outnumbered, the Japanese warriors wonder how long they can fend off the enemy. Then, a typhoon arrives, destroying the invading armada and saving Japan. The storm is attributed to the sun goddess. The tale has been told to every Japanese schoolboy and girl since. This event took place as the feudal system in Japan was developing. Among the powerful castes at the time were the samurai, the warrior class, who essentially ruled the country until the 19th century. Also during this time, the samurai developed an unwritten code, which came to be called Bushido. Bushido called for bravery and athletic prowess, but above all else, allegiance to the emperor, who was regarded as a god on earth. The architects of the kamikaze squads called on these centuries-old traditions. They invoked the words of the Emperor Meiji from the 1880s. Bear in mind that duty is weightier than a mountain, while death is as light as a feather. The Knights of the Divine Wind were instilled with religious duty. While religious freedom was espoused in Japan, Shinto practices were expected of every citizen, and especially of every soldier, including the recognition of the emperor as a god on earth. All of this came together in the kamikaze farewell ritual. The commander would toast the pilots with sake rice wine, a present from the emperor. The pilots were guaranteed a place at the Yasukuni Shrine, a posthumous promotion in rank, and to have their exploits mentioned to Emperor Hirohito. "See You at the Shrine" was a popular farewell as pilots jumped into their planes for their one-way missions. Japan was a refined culture, of which these pilots were rightfully proud. They were told by their superiors that their sacrifice was the only way to preserve that culture, the only way to preserve their very homes.
The security, the very existence of our families was threatened. Women, children, and old men had already been among the innumerable and pathetic victims of bombing and machine gun fire. It was therefore natural that we should go to any length, regardless of our own safety, to protect our families. Nagatsuka Ryuji, Japanese Army Air Force.
Before heading out on a mission, the men would write a final letter home. The letters have a haunting quality.
I precede you now, Mother, in the approach to heaven. Pray for me, Mother. Ensign Hayashi Ichizo. Don't be envious of your friends' daddies. Your daddy has become our God and is always watching you. Lieutenant Colonel Kuno Masanobu. Dear Moko, grow up to be a healthy and big girl. Daddy will make an attack on the enemies. When you grow up, you will understand. Lieutenant Umemura Masahisa.
But why would these militarists even think to sacrifice their best and brightest?
If your hands are broken, fight with your feet. If your feet are broken, fight with your teeth. If there is no breath left in your body, fight with your ghost. General Sakurai Tokutarō.
As the ships in the Leyte Gulf prepared to commence the largest naval battle in history, General MacArthur made his triumphant landing on Philippine territory. It had been a grueling year and a half since the Japanese occupied the Philippines in the wake of their success at Pearl Harbor, and General MacArthur, forced off the island, vowed, "I shall return." Finally, on October 20th, 1944, he was able to make good on his promise. However, it would be months until he was able to end Japanese occupation of all the Philippine islands. As the Allies continued to press through the scattered Philippines from late October past the New Year, kamikazes attacked the ships in the Lingayen Gulf. In an effort to stave off the invasion of the island of Luzon, home of the Philippine capital, Manila. The lower admirals implored the U.S. Pacific commander, Admiral Nimitz, to order raids on the airfield from which these aerial assaults were originating, but resources were already spread thin. One of those admirals, William Bull Halsey, who headed the kamikaze vulnerable Third Fleet, prevailed. And carrier planes began working over Japanese-controlled Clark Field and the other suspected air bases. Unfortunately, Japanese mechanics had become masters at hiding the aircraft in the nearby jungles and constructing decoys to park on the field. The U.S. bombed many Zeros during those months, not realizing that many of them were mere plywood mock-ups. It would be some time before Allied planners would catch on. To them, it just seemed that somehow the kamikazes kept coming and coming, as did the carnage. On October 30th, three fleet carriers near the Philippine island of Cebu took serious hits. Gas fires raged on the Intrepid, but the fearless control team tackled the blaze swiftly and skillfully. The damage to the Franklin, which was the first carrier to be hit by a kamikaze just 2 weeks before, was the worst of the three, but casualties were relatively light. The dead and wounded on the Belleau Wood were a different story. 92 men perished. Another 54 were seriously injured. Both the Franklin and the Belleau Wood had to be taken out of the war for repairs. Through October and November, highly prized fleet carriers like the Lexington, the Essex, the Hancock, as well as nearly every one of the smaller escort carriers had fallen prey to the Japanese special attack forces in the Philippines. Tension mounted on board as the crew began to feel like sitting ducks. As the new year approached, both sides prayed for an end to the war on their own terms. The Japanese prayed for the invaders to be repelled by their gods of the divine wind. And the Allies prayed that the Emperor would realize the folly of continuing a war that he could not win. Both sides would have to wait for an answer to their prayers. The year went out on a terrible note as a typhoon blew in on December 17th, as if to repeat the divine wind from which the kamikazes took their name. It found Halsey's fleet, and however he tried to evade it, it seemed to follow him. The fleet floundered, losing more than 800 men. A lull in the suicide raids allowed the Americans to lick their wounds, but not for long. Desperate for targets, and dreading returning to base without completing their missions, the kamikaze started threatening smaller ships. And as 1944 became 1945, the assaults heated up once more. Those smaller ships bore the brunt of the renewed Japanese vengeance. December 28, 1944, here a cameraman caught in full-fledged kamikaze assault doesn't know where to point his camera. He just missed a suicide plane slamming into the ammunition ship, the USS John Burke. The Burke was destroyed in seconds, with the loss of every single man on board. Eventually, the American CAPs, or combat air patrols, got better and better at intercepting the kamikazes. But on the afternoon of January 6th, several suicide flyers and their escorts managed to sneak through to the ships in the Lingayen Gulf that were helping to shake the rest of the Japanese out of the Philippines. The Japanese special attackers went right for the flagship of the task force, the battleship New Mexico. A fully loaded Zero smashed directly into the bridge. Unlike other kinds of combat, the naval commanders were often as much in the line of fire as the lowliest grunt on board. And that was never more true than during a kamikaze attack. Although Vice Admiral Jesse Oldendorf was not injured, the captain of the ship was killed, along with a leading aide to Great Britain's Winston Churchill. A correspondent from Time magazine was also among the dead. This first major attack of the year filled both sides with a sense of dread. What would the rest of 1945 bring? It would be the final year of the kamikazes. World War II, the largest, most brutal conflict of all time. One of the most horrific aspects was the advent of the suicide bomber, the kamikaze. These aviators were ordered to certain death to try to save an empire, and they unleashed a new and seemingly invincible strategy into the annals of military history. How do you defend yourself against an enemy willing to kill himself as long as he can take you with him? That was a question to which the Allies had no real answer.
Every time one country gets something, another soon has it. One country gets radar, but soon all have it. One gets a new type of engine or plane, then another gets it. But the Japs have got the kamikaze boys, and nobody else is going to get that, because nobody else is built that way. Captain John Thatch, Operations Officer to Admiral McCain.
By January 1945, 100 American ships were sunk or damaged, including two escort carriers sunk, nine larger carriers damaged, five battleships damaged, and there had been 4,000 American casualties. All of that damage was done by 400 Japanese suicide bombers, aided by 100 escorts. Was the worst yet to come? The answer to that question would be yes. The Americans were forced to abandon the Philippines in May 1942. Now, starting with October 1944's Battle of Leyte Gulf, they were making the final push to regain the islands. Rear Admiral Takajiro Onishi decided to evacuate what was left of his special attack units, taking with them the remainder of the useful aircraft. He left behind the ground crew and mechanics who had so creatively kept the most dilapidated planes in good enough shape for one final mission. They were ordered to stay behind to fight as infantry down to the last man in their own kind of suicide mission. The pilots themselves continued to have a range of emotions about their missions, a range as varied as the individuals whose volunteering was becoming a lot less voluntary. In fact, reprisals for not answering the call were so severe, some pilots were virtually ordered into their new special attack units. Not everyone felt the compulsion to die. They called the suicide enthusiast kitschy guy or madman. But the motives of each pilot were complicated. The vast majority were quite sane. They were doing their duty. They were fulfilling a lifetime of training in samurai ethics and Bushido spirit.
Please congratulate me. I have been given a splendid opportunity to die. How I wish I could be born 7 times, each time to smite the enemy. I shall return in spirit and look forward to your visit to the Yasukuni Shrine. Flying Petty Officer Matsuo Iseo.
With kamikaze units now depleted by their successful missions, a fresh unit was formed on January 18th. They celebrated with a mission to seek out the American fleet off the coast of Formosa. Two of those planes crashed into the USS Ticonderoga, then just 1 month old. The ship was only saved by the quick thinking of its damage parties, as directed by Captain Dixie Kiefer. He purposely flooded the port side. The tilt helped put out the fires. After a busy January, U.S. military planners used a momentary lull in the hostilities to rack their brains about how to counter the suicide plane development. With the Philippines more or less under control, Admiral Halsey withdrew his carrier fleet from the area as he tried to piece together a solution. Even after 4 months of devastating attacks, the only effective defense the U.S. Navy utilized was shooting at the incoming planes until they disintegrated.
A loader on the forward port gun commented as the third plane was about to strike near his position, "If that son of a bitch has the guts to dive in here, I've got the guts to shoot back." Mr. Shiri remained at his station and was immediately knocked unconscious upon impact. Ray Mayhew, USS Bush.
The Allies' best bet when it came to knocking out the Japanese aviation industry and the kamikazes it supplied was the newly introduced B-29. This new bomber was so huge, it earned the nickname Super Fortress, and it was the biggest aircraft on either side of the war. It could carry nearly 10 tons of bombs and promised to be the advantage that the Allies needed, but they had to get it within safe flying distance of the main island of Japan. Saipan in the Marianas Islands, which had been won by the Americans back in June 1944, was the closest airstrip, but it was some 1,500 miles from Tokyo. That meant that the fighters protecting the B-29s bombing Tokyo only had enough fuel to accompany them on part of the mission, and the bombers themselves had no place to land if they were damaged or had mechanical failures. But there was one island, roughly halfway between Saipan and Tokyo. The Americans targeted it as their next conquest. That island was called Iwo Jima. Because it was the only suitable site for an airfield between the Marianas Islands and the home islands, the Japanese knew that one day they would have to defend Iwo Jima. Since the beginning of hostilities, they fortified it with a network of caves and bunkers, the likes of which the U.S. Marines had never seen. On February 19, 1945, the invasion of Iwo Jima began. Facing the Americans were more than 20,000 dug-in Japanese soldiers. No more than 200 would survive to tell the tale. Though there was a slim chance of survival, these last-ditch efforts were their own kind of suicide mission. It was clear that the Japanese soldiers on Iwo Jima were calling on the same spirit and traditions that drove the Kamikaze Corps. The battle for Iwo Jima is remembered as one of the toughest ground battles in the history of warfare. The Allied landings were supported by a huge armada, doing its best to soften up those dug-in fortifications. The Kamikazes, now operating from Formosa, or present-day Taiwan, were preparing to reduce the power of that fleet. Initially, very few of them got through. Then, on the third day of battle, the USS Saratoga was pounded by four separate ramming attacks, causing such damage that her flyers who were up in the air trying to shoot down the bogies had nowhere to land.
Saratoga Action Report, 21 February, 1945, 1700 hours. Number one plane, hit and on fire, crashed into starboard side, penetrated hangar deck. Violent explosions. Number two plane, hit and on fire, hit water and bounced into starboard side at waterline. Number five plane, hit and burning, headed for bridge, carried away antenna and signal halyard, crashed into catapult and exploded violently. Number six plane, hit and crashed into airplane crane on starboard side, rest of plane went overside.
Nearby ships came to the rescue. This was hardly the one plane, one ship ideal that the Japanese admirals and generals wanted, but the multi-aircraft strategy had the desired result. Old Sarah survived, but would never return to combat. On the same day, an escort carrier, the USS Bismarck Sea, was sunk by two kamikazes. This was the third Jeep carrier sunk by kamikazes since they began operations. These baby flat tops were only around 500 feet long, compared to the 900-foot Essex-class ships like the Franklin, the Intrepid, and the Hancock. Jeep carriers were never designed to take a direct hit. They were merely converted merchant ships meant for training and escorting duty. Now, three of them rested at the bottom of the ocean. The combined support fleet off the coast of Iwo Jima saw just 24 kamikazes. Navy officials could only hope that the phenomenon was dying down. They couldn't have been more wrong. Though the losses to the Navy support ships numbered into the hundreds, they paled in comparison to casualties on the island, where 6,000 were killed and another 17,000 were injured. Finally, on March 16th, after nearly a month of ferocious fighting, Iwo Jima could be called Allied territory. As the island hopping entered a brief quiet period, some of the carriers were removed back to their base in the Caroline Islands, over 1,200 miles from Iwo Jima. It was thought they'd be safe there. On the evening of March 11th, as the sailors were chatting before their nightly movie, some of the men saw a lone plane in the sky. John Montserrat was aboard the USS Langley when his friend pointed out the plane.
Tom said, "Look at that idiot flying around up there without any wing lights." That idiot, a fully armed kamikaze, dove his airplane and his bomb into the Randolph. After a huge explosion, there was a stunned silence for a moment. And then pandemonium, as ship after ship went to general quarters, darkened ship, and manned their guns. John Montserrat, USS Langley.
On March 19th, two U.S. carriers fell prey to conventional dive bombers within 2 minutes of each other. The Wasp and the Franklin were both reminded that so-called old-fashioned weapons could be just as deadly as kamikazes. The blast from the Franklin could be heard on the USS Bunker Hill, stationed 50 miles away. Over the span of the war, the Franklin and its crew became the most decorated in Navy history. Two men aboard the carrier earned the Medal of Honor that day for extraordinary heroism during armed combat. One of them was Father Joseph T. O'Callaghan, seen here giving last rites. O'Callaghan earned the award by helping men find escape from within the smoky corridors and for directing the damage control efforts. His commander called him the bravest man I ever saw. The USS Franklin had served in the Marianas and the Carolines. It had been the first carrier ever hit by a suicide bomber and later rebounded after an even more serious kamikaze strike during the Battle of Leyte Gulf. But this attack was the knockout blow. The Franklin limped home to New York with a skeleton crew. The war was over for this Essex-class carrier. The kamikaze attacks shook Navy rank and file to the core. They tried to unwind, but the tension built daily. Clearly, they were never safe from a ramming attack, even in port. But they had no idea what other innovations of warfare the Japanese military was concocting. As the Allies prepared for their next move, carrier planes from the 58th Task Force witnessed something that defied description over the Japanese home island of Kyushu. Some new kind of winged bombs were strapped to the bottom of Mitsubishi bombers. The Allies had no way of knowing at the time that this was the next escalation of the divine wind concept. What they were looking at was a true death machine. The reality had to be faced. The Japanese people might one day have to defend their homeland from invasion by the American demons and their fortress-like bombers. They did what they could to protect themselves from these bombers, but the protection was designed for American B-25s. While the weapon of choice now for the Allies would be the massive B-29. B-29s fly at 30,000 feet. The surface-to-air missiles placed around Tokyo reached only 25,000 feet. To make matters worse, the Japanese fighter planes could not reach those altitudes either. The result was an air superiority that would thoroughly demoralize the Japanese military. After the capture of Iwo Jima, firebombing raids on Japanese cities started in earnest. And since most Japanese buildings were constructed of timber and pulp products, the incendiary bombs were viciously effective. On March 10th, more than 1 million were left homeless by the American air raid on Tokyo. Approximately 100,000 people were killed, and the super fortresses just kept coming. It seemed that there was nothing the Japanese army could do about it. Again, Japan was shocked at its vulnerability. No one more so than the newest advocate of the Kamikaze Corps, the head of the 5th Air Fleet.
The enemy comes into our imperial city at high altitude and carries out indiscriminate bombing. It is a complete shock to see them do such things as bomb a shrine. Vice Admiral Matome Ugaki.
Ugaki and his colleagues could come up with only one way to protect themselves against the B-29, which they begrudgingly gave the title of B-san, a mark of respect. They were called Taiatari, or ramming attacks, but the American aviators lumped them in with other suicide missions and called them kamikaze. Simply put, Japanese aviation engineers took all shielding and guns off their fighter planes to make them light enough to reach the same altitude as the super fortresses. Now that pilots could reach them, they were told to put themselves in between the B-sans and the homeland. The name of the new unit was Shinten, or Earthshaking, and they held to the idea of Keshtai, or Dare to Die. Many did just that. When you saw one of those guys coming at you, said a member of one American bomber crew, it put a fear into you like you've never known. But the number of U.S. bombers was too overwhelming. The firebombs made some in Japanese society even more dedicated to the quickly disappearing dream of victory. After all, they had been told for years of the nightmare scenario in which American demons would wipe out their nation and take their women.
It is not for the Emperor, nor Japan, that I undertake this suicide attack, but solely for my beloved wife. Lieutenant Yukio Seki, 201st Air Group.
But the violence also led others to wonder what they were fighting for, and if there was a way peace could be achieved without the complete destruction of their nation.
It leaves a bad taste in my mouth when I think of the deceit being played on innocent citizens by some of our wily politicians. But I am willing to take orders from the high command and even from the politicians because I believe in the polity of Japan. Ensign Yamaguchi Teruo.
At the same time, the Japanese developed a new chapter in suicide weaponry, the Oka, or cherry blossom bomb. The Allies dubbed it the Baka, or fool's bomb. The first good look the Americans got at these suicide machines were several Oka 11s captured on Okinawa. Equipped with no takeoff or landing gear, these were true suicide machines. So simple in design, yet their rockets could propel them to 600 miles per hour. They were only 20 feet of tin and plywood, but each carried 3 rockets and 1,800 pounds of explosives. But how did they work? Germany had startled the world with their V-1 and V-2. The German buzz bombs were used to amazing effectiveness against Britain, but they were blind bombs. Hitler's army merely pointed them using the best coordinates they could manage at the time and hoped to hit a significant target. The Nazis weren't completely satisfied with the devastation and thought, what if a rocket bomb could be steered? The Japanese were impressed with the technology that their Axis power friends were sharing with them, and they took it one step farther. The Allies may have called the Japanese rocket-propelled weapon the Fool's Bomb, but it was chillingly clever. The idea was that the Oka rode below a Mitsubishi bomber, which the Allies named the Betty Bomber. When the bomber approached the target, the pilot, part of the specially formed Thunder Gods unit, would climb down to the plane through the bomb bay. He would then speed toward the intended ship, with no other way to land but to crash. The speed was so blindingly fast that gunners hardly had a chance to aim. On the day this footage was shot, in March 1945, U.S. flyers noticed winged bombs underneath the Bettys they were attacking. They had no way of knowing they were suicide planes. All of the Bettys were shot down before they could release their payload. But the Okas would be back the following month to play a part in the sinking of an American destroyer and damaging a few other ships. Still, the Thunder Gods never truly had the opportunity to display what their powerful weapons could do. Also being constructed during this time were the Shinyo, or ocean-shaking boats, small vessels originally designed to drop depth charges alongside offshore ships. The people steering the craft had a narrow margin of escape. As the war got more and more hopeless, the kamikaze concept spread to other kinds of vessels, even these small boats powered by automobile and truck engines. The bows of these boats were loaded with explosives. They were meant to ram invading vessels close to shore. A plunger mechanism was added to ensure a massive explosion upon impact. Another method of special attack was born. As with the kamikaze planes and Okas, the boat, the explosive, and the driver were one unit, one bomb.
Almost completely undamaged, a flotilla of so-called suicide boats is discovered.
When the Allies occupied Japan, they found hundreds of these boats, with evidence that many more were planned, all designed to thwart invasion of the homeland. It was more evidence of the government's commitment to preserving the Japanese spirit, even if it meant losing the Japanese people. Suicide attacks could be launched in many ways. These midget submarines were actually human torpedoes intended for a two-man suicide crew. They were called Kaiten, or Heaven Shakers. Various models were the five-man Kaiyu, called the Sea Dragon, and the Koryu, another tiny two-man sub. They were originally intended as stealth versions of their larger cousins. But by 1944, their conventional torpedoes were packed with hair trigger charges, and the operators of the boats were instructed to simply ram them into their target vessel. Japanese I boats like these were quickly converted into motherships for these new mini subs. In addition to regular torpedoes, they could now release these human torpedoes as well. They would sneak into a suitable range without detection, then release their Kaitens for a guaranteed hit. The suicide subs made their debut in a spectacular fashion with the sinking of this oiler, the USS Mississinewa. Kaiten also sunk another destroyer escort and damaged several others. Records show that the Japanese were gearing up to produce many more of these suicide subs for the inevitable invasion of Japan. One can only wonder how much devastation they would have wrought. But the most incredible plan for a special attack was to take place off the coast of Okinawa. By the spring of 1945, the once proud Japanese Navy had been reduced to a handful of ships, with precious little fuel left even to operate them. The admirals of Japan hatched an idea to stave off the inevitable invasion of Okinawa, the logical stepping stone to the home islands of Japan. The plan was to send 10 ships, virtually all that was left of the fleet, on a suicide assignment. Included would be the pride of the nation, the Yamato, the largest battleship ever built. The plan was to beach the Yamato. All 2,498 sailors aboard would man the guns until, one by one, they were all silenced. The crewmen never got a chance to display their Bushido-driven valor in combat. On the way to its date with destiny, the fleet, including the noble Yamato, met torpedoes launched from carrier planes of Admiral Mitcher's fabled Task Force 58. Mitcher's men were battle-hardened after involvement in every major action since the Marshall Islands in January of the previous year. It took a concerted effort from all of them to sink the mighty Japanese battleship. Perhaps Admiral Onishi was right after all. The Yamato might have done more good melted down and used for scrap to build airplanes. Gone with the Yamato was the hope for an easy victory at Okinawa. On the island-hopping campaign toward the Japanese main island, Okinawa was the next logical place for the U.S. to strike. Both sides knew it. It was the largest island in the closest island chain to Japan proper. The Americans would need that springboard for final victory. At the time of the initial landings on April 1, 1945, 155,000 men were deployed in Operation Iceberg. By the end of the battle, some 300,000 American troops were committed to the vicious fighting. Waiting for them were 120,000 dug-in Japanese troops, five times as many as had so skillfully defended Iwo Jima. Supporting the Allied invasion was the largest fleet ever assembled. More than 1,200 ships of all kinds participated, including the contribution of the British fleet. To the Knights of the Divine Wind, this was an irresistible target. And they came out in waves. One sailor called them a swarm of angry bees. Another compared them to Indians circling a wagon trail. Colorful descriptions aside, the waves of kamikazes were so intense that most of the U.S. aerial assault runs were diverted to destroying their air bases. The fleet was so massive and the kamikaze corps so important to the imperial cause that Japanese soldiers on the island were told to cease fire while the kamikazes did their work. In this final year of the war, Admiral Mark A. Mitcher was the leader of the fast carrier group Task Force 58. Considering the kamikazes' love of destroying flat tops, that was a dangerous position to hold. Early in the battle, the well-liked Mitcher decided to make the Bunker Hill his flagship. He was often on deck in his famous baseball cap. On May 11th at 10:04, he got an up-close look at the hazard that his sailors had been dealing with for months. A Zero sneaked past a combat air patrol and smashed into 34 planes on the deck of the Bunker Hill. Less than a minute later, a Judy smashed through the aft flight deck. The whole thing happened less than 100 feet from where the Admiral was standing. The Bunker Hill would go on to fight another day, but 353 of its men, including 13 from the Admiral's staff, wouldn't. As the Bunker Hill made its repairs, Mitcher prepared to transfer his flag to another flat top. His entire quarters had been destroyed, along with all of his records. Here we see the Admiral and the surviving members of his staff boarding the USS Enterprise, hoping to command from this vantage point. But just 3 days later, the Enterprise fell into the sights of 28 enemy aircraft. One of them got through the ACAC fire to hit smack into the middle of the ship. Legend has it that while all around him hit the deck, Mitcher was on his feet for the entire affair. Although the old lady sustained relatively light casualties, the physical damage was severe. She had fought in every major battle in the Pacific theater, but this was the last day of the war for the Big E. For his part, Mitcher transferred once again, this time to the USS Randolph, which had taken its own lumps that fateful night at Utile back in March, when all hands went to general quarters instead of the nightly movie. He had more reasons than ever for pleading with the Pacific commander to finally get rid of those kamikaze air bases. With still no tangible way to repel the aerial kamikazes, the commander-in-chief for the Pacific Theater, Admiral Nimitz, conferred with other high-ranking officials and even put out a call to everyone in the fleet for ideas on how to reduce the menace. Someone, although history does not know exactly who, came up with the picket defense. It involved sending smaller craft, destroyers, and minesweepers ahead of the fleet in the hopes of picking up the kamikazes on radar before they hit the main fleet and the Navy's precious aircraft carriers. It was a dangerous assignment, and some of the men called the pickets tethered goats, after the age-old shepherd's trick of sending the weakest of the flock to be attacked by wolves to save the rest. Indeed, the desperate kamikazes, wanting to do anything to avoid returning home to face the shame of failure and the prospect of preparing once again to die, descended on these smaller craft with a vengeance. It seemed by this point that a kamikaze would go after any kind of Allied vessel, from battleship to troop transports. Although the picket defense worked, the casualties were high, as were the numbers of sinkings. On April 6, 1945, the destroyer USS Bush was manning radar picket number one off Okinawa. At 3:15 p.m., a single-engine fighter, codenamed Jill, slammed into the stacks of the Bush. Its bomb took out everything from the engine room to the galley and sick bay.
I was one of the first to get up the ladder to the second level. Most of the men didn't make it up because of the steam. Once topside, we found out what kind of shape we were in. We were burning below decks and dead in the water. Frank Grigsby, water tender third class.
There were still a dozen hellbirds in the sky, and every time a nearby vessel would approach to help the Bush, it too would be attacked. Then, another plane hit the ship. The flames subsided, but it was a lost cause. Captain Rollin E. Westholm was the last to leave the ship, and then only after the doctor threatened to shoot him off.
We were watching the bridge and the bow burn when she finally slipped into the water. The flag that flew so proudly on the bow was the last thing I saw go under. I cried. James Oakey Reeder, USS Bush.
Many were saved that day by nearby rescue ships. 87 seamen and 7 officers were not. It took 2 months to neutralize the deeply dug-in garrison of soldiers at Okinawa. Combat had been more ferocious than ever as the suicide concept extended to the ground war. Human bullets, soldiers with explosives strapped to their bodies, took out tanks. Again, there seemed to be no defense against someone bent on sacrificing himself. In the aftermath, it was apparent that even ordinary Japanese citizens were committed to suicide over defeat. Any fate was better to them than capture by the American demons they had been taught to fear. The Japanese people braced for the invasion of the homeland. Ordinary civilians were being organized into their own suicide brigades, while the entire military was put on notice to convert to special attack duty. Leaders envisioned a force of nearly 100 million, all willing to kill themselves in the effort to repel the invaders. Radio Tokyo boasted that the sooner the Americans attacked, the better. Everyone involved knew that if Guadalcanal, Tarawa, Saipan, Iwo Jima, and Okinawa were hard-fought battles, the battle for the homeland would be far, far worse. With victory so distant and devastation so near, the emperor's subjects continued to fight.
Even if we are defeated, the noble spirits of the Kamikaze Attack Corps will keep our homeland from ruin. Without this spirit, our nation would cease to exist. Admiral Kakijiro Onishi.
The Japanese military stepped up its production of suicide submarines, and a bold plan was formulated to launch the Okas from catapults at the invading Allied ships in order to overcome the lack of aircraft to carry the human bombs. And still, aerial kamikazes continued to strike. Through June and July, they attacked any ships they could reach. As July became August, nearly 5,500 planes of all kinds were earmarked for one-way missions, and an equal number of pilots were in training for special attacks. If all of these planes were actually launched, this horrible war could have been prolonged even further, causing unimaginable agony on both sides. Some historians believe that the prospect of widespread ramming attacks directed against an invasion of the main Japanese island contributed to President Harry S. Truman's decision to unleash the atomic bomb. The horror of the atomic bombs may have brought about the end of the war, but it also opened up a new chapter of fear and panic. The West could not understand how the military could organize suicide bombers against military targets. The East could not understand how the United States could kill so many women and children in Hiroshima and Nagasaki. On August 15, 1945, the impossible happened. The voice of the sacred crane was heard for the first time by his subjects. The emperor made a radio address informing Japan that he was ready to call a halt to the war. His subjects had been prepared to fight to the end, and now they were giving their country to their mortal enemy. Hundreds committed suicide so as not to face the dishonor. After hearing the emperor's words, Admiral Ugaki, the revered head of Japan's 5th Air Fleet, boarded a plane in search of the enemy and implored his pilots to carry on with the struggle. He was never heard from again. Harakiri was the samurai's way of avoiding shame through ritual suicide. In the final days, Harakiri was invoked by the father of the kamikaze. Exhausted Admiral Onishi, father of the Divine Wind, followed the men he directed to death. Finally, peace came with the signing of formal terms of surrender on September 2, 1945. The solemn ceremony took place aboard the battleship Missouri, which had shrugged off kamikaze attacks herself. Since then, the two countries have become allies. The era of the kamikaze seems a nightmare dreamt long ago. A poem by Admiral Onishi, the architect of the Japanese Special Attack Corps, says it all. In blossom today, then scattered, life is so like a delicate flower. How can one expect the fragrance to last forever?